Chase this morning. I'm Jon Kingston, and today we're talking a little bit about horticultural therapy and how it can help your home. So I'm going to be running you through a few of the things that I've been doing over the last few years. And then also we're going to be talking about how that can be adapted into your everyday life and things that you can do to make your living environment more positive. So, just a little bit about me. I've been working in horticulture about 30 years, and a lot of that's been based around a practice with domestic garden, where I'm installing gardens, designing gardens, maintaining gardens, that sort of thing. Then about 8 years ago, I got into community gardening, and community gardening revolutionised the way that I live in Redfern at the time. So I lived there for about 5 years. It's in the second house, sort of just around the corner from the first house, and I still only knew about three people in the entire suburb. So once we actually got a community garden going, all the people on the street knew each other, the people started talking to each other, a lot of people started engaging by walking past the garden and having little chats. Now from that point, I then started volunteering at Wayside Chapel. So Indira Martin, who was here last week doing one of those talks, did one for me. I think she did actually 1,000 launches over 2 books over 5 years. So I met her at one of those and she invited me up to Wayside to volunteer there. And then after 4 years of volunteering there, I started actually working there 2 days a week. So, Wayside Chapel's a really interesting place to work. We've got a little motto, which is love over hate, which you can see on my shirt here. And what that means is that we're working alongside people, and we're not there to fix people. We have the idea that every person has their right to their own path, right and wrong. So everything we do at Wayside Chapel is actually informed by that. So our visitor base is really varied. And it represents most of the different cultures and ethnicities across Australia. And the people who visit, they might be from homeless populations, people with addictions, people with mental health issues, and people who are socially isolated. And that's a really big thing in modern society, social isolation. A lot of people don't know anyone around them. A lot of people don't have that in their contact with others. And with that social isolation and homelessness and all those things, they're the people that, you know, you ignore on the street. They're the people you don't see as you go around your everyday life. So my role is to engage people, you know, work with plants and gardening, and to get them to rejoin community. So if you've been sort of socially marginalised for a long time, it is very difficult to communicate with a lot of people. So we use plants and gardening as a way of doing that. So this is one of our visitors gardening up here. You can see he's telling me something he's found in the garden. So you can see that little pathway to communication. So you give people a little bit of space to explore themselves. And then that sort of brings, you know, a lot of joy to a lot of people. So the aim is to develop new skills, reactivate old skills, and open pathways for creativity and community engagement, and a renewed sense of self and a sense of positivity that, you know, that life can change, life can improve. So we do that by creating an enriched environment. So you never know what's going to spark engagement in each participant. So you've got neurodiverse populations which have very different needs in the space. So I went to a talk earlier this year, and we were learning about a garden that had been installed at a children's school in England. Now, it's a school for children, you know, who are on the autistic spectrum, but it's also a school for children who have a range of things that are pathologised in modern society. So things like developmental delays, physical disabilities, all that sort of thing. So they actually have to put in two gardens for the two two very distinct populations. So for the kids on the spectrum side of the fence, they had a very still, quiet garden with no surprises. So straight lines, things in boxes, everything very neat and tidy. The only change throughout the year for the entire section of the garden was they got red flowers that flowered for a month every spring. So everything else is green and white, no surprises. The other side of the fence is a much more typical horticultural therapy garden, where you have a huge range of different experiences. So the experiences that you'd find would be things that you find in nature. So life, movement, sensory features, textures. And somehow or other, about a year before that, I put in a garden in Bondo, which is also part of the Wayside Chapel. And we managed to put both of those types of garden in. So we find that some of our visitors who you know, are on that spectrum, they're looking at the green wall side of the garden with coffee bushes and a very minor undergrowth of gingers and things. And then the other side's a First Nations garden or food forest where we're actually looking across to you know, lots of flowers and bright things. And this is in the dining area. So people actually tend to orient themselves in the direction that's comfortable for them. So one of those things, the points that you get from that is you need to find an actual area of garden that speaks to you. So every person has a different style of garden or outdoor space that speaks to them. There's no one way of interpreting landscape. There's no one way of gardening. You know, if you walk around Mossman or even around this area, often you will think, oh, you know, all the gardens are the same. You know, they are, people copy it. But there's a lot more out there. And there are some amazing ways of changing, you know, the way your home is regarding. So every novel visitor, so every time a person's in our garden for the first time, quite excited, regardless of who they are, they might be homeless, they might be someone who's just popping off the street because they've heard we've got a great garden and they want to attend our garden class on a Thursday. So they get a tour with the garden that's tailored to their needs. So they're looking at touch as smell, and we're observing the garden's life. So the food plants that we're growing are botanically diverse. So we're growing things from as many different parent cultures as possible. So Australia's made up of a lot of different immigrant cultures and also a whole bunch of other domestic First Nations cultures. So we're growing as many different things as possible from all of those, so that anyone who comes into the garden is able to have an experience where they will recognise something other by sight, touch, taste, smell. So often, you know, you might have someone who comes in with some plant like lemongrass. Okay? And if someone's from Southeast Asia, they'll recognise lemongrass as something that mum cooked or grandma cooked, and they'll get a really good memory from that. Okay? It may be a happy family experience that they had when the whole family was together before things went wrong. It might also be that they know a recipe for something they'll share, and then we'll use that in our cooking class later as well. So that's how you can sort of bring people in for engagement through the different plants that we did. So we had one of our First Nations visitors who was having a pretty awful time in her life. She was attending Wayside downstairs and going to showers and that sort of thing quite regularly. I'm not going to go into what her lifestyle was and what she was doing, but she came up once and attended. Now, she's since passed. You know, she passed quite young, like a lot of people who live on the street do. But she found a plant, you know, as part of that exploratory tour of the garden that she recognised. It's just a little herbaceous plant with a tiny little blue flower. And it's used by First Nations cultures up and down the east coast of Australia for basket weaving and string making. So we planted it as part of our program to show the history of First Nations agriculture, because contrary to popular opinion, agriculture didn't start with white people in this country. It actually went on for well over 50,000 years prior to white colonisation of Australia. A lot of people lived in villages, a lot of people grew crops, and this plant, as well as being used for strings, basket making, it's used in particular for the seed, which is very high in protein, and it was using reds and cats. So, and that's another story, in that those reds and cats have been made in New South Wales for 35,000 years, and in Western Australia for at least 65,000 years, in the northwest where people first came into the country. Now, that's an important point, because if you look at Egypt, you're looking at 15,000 years for everything to be made. So you're looking at a very, very ancient agrarian culture in Australia. And a lot of our First Nations visitors don't have access to family histories. They don't have access to their families. They'll take it off their parents take off their parents as government policy. It's very difficult to have pride in your own culture and your ethnicity if you don't know what that is. So I think that's sort of another important point of things that you can actually do with plants. And so this particular visitor had come into the garden. She found something she'd recognised. When she was about 13, 14, she was going through puberty. She was going off the rails. And her aunties and her grandmother had taken her up the river on their traditional country. So they were walking across farmland. They were walking across other people's property, but on their traditional country, and they'd taken her out to learn about her culture in the hope of bringing her back in. Unfortunately, that didn't happen. But, 15 years down the track, here she was having this beautiful memory and actually understanding what her family had been trying to do. So that's one of the ways you can get contact with people and reinforce positive memories. All right, so one of the other things that we do in the garden is not every culture can be represented through plants. So there's growing acknowledgement of transgender and non-binary communities in Australia. And a lot of people are being misgendered. They're not being called by the proper pronouns. People don't understand what they're talking about. So we actually have a mannequin who guards the entrance to the garden. Sometimes they start with people as they come through the door. But Rain is there as an interpretive sign effectively. So we get our trans and non-binary communities at Wayside to redress Rain about every 6 months, because obviously they're outside. Things get a little bit shabby and dry after a while, and you look at the cobwebs. But there's a whole bunch of interpretive signs. So the point of that is everyone's welcome in our garden. Okay, so we're using different styles of foods. We're acknowledging where things come from. So things like sweet basil and eggplants come from India. And a lot of people think sweet basil comes from Italy. A lot of people think that eggplants might come from Thailand or something like that. But then you've also got your tomatoes that come from South America. And then we'll also have a native crest that comes from Western Sydney. The islands used to grow before colonisation. The farmers put their settlers put their cattle across the water meadows and destroy most of the crop. Okay, so everyone gets a tour the first time they come into the garden. And I work with my volunteers to provide an experience where the visitor feels comfortable engaging with and being themselves. So we've got a young couple here. They'll live on the streets at the time. So they've come up to sort of have a little date in the garden. Because there's nowhere else that's quiet and private where they can just have a little chat about things and not be sort of wrapped up in the trauma of everyday life on the streets. So we're providing a respite through conversation and activity that might be a mindfulness practice, it might be a creative activity, it might be a physical activity. So one of our visitors at one point came up, and she was non-communicative. She'd been living on trains for quite a while. She had an abusive background as a child, as an adult. She had developed mental issues, and she was living on the trains. So she'd come in and access Wayside. She could barely whisper to the female staff because of the level of abuse that she's copped in her life. And I gave her a little tour of the garden, and she sort of listened without listening. Because I was a male and therefore a threat. But then down the track, I asked her what she wanted to do. We had a bed, so one of our big pots that we were turning over for new crops. And I gave her a trowel, and she murdered the bed. so she'll actually be able to take out that frustration through the physical action of gardening. And then she actually engaged in the garden for about 2 years to things that she was more interested in.
Okay, I've got another story about a bit of it. So she was having the worst day of her life. Her partner had just passed away from an overdose. So her former partner, who was the parent of her children. She'd been kicked out of her house by family members who got an AVO against her while she was detoxing. She'd been kicked out of the refuge that she was in, and her health was really bad. So she was wandering the streets crying, trying to figure out what the hell she was going to do next. And she happened to stumble past Wayside and saw a friend out in the courtyard. So she's there, and I come down every Thursday at 3. It's like, hey, everyone, what are you going to go with me? Let's have fun on the roof. And she was like, he's a bit of a dag. No one seems to want to go up. I'm not really into gardening, but I feel a bit sorry for him. And so she came up to the garden, but we actually had about 10 participants that day. And so she got the tour, she got her hands a little bit dirty, and she then sat down at the table, had a conversation with him. She actually got to meet herself for the first time. So just her having a chat with other people, the first time in about 5 months. And that has an amazing transformative effect.
So now she's still engaging with gardening after a couple of years, and she talks often about how she needs to get her hands dirty. And what people don't seem to realise is everyone's trying to be really hygienic, trying to get dirt's going to make them sick. There are now studies that say that dirt actually makes you better. So you've got the little bacteria in the soil, and the bacteria have little fats. And the University of Colorado has published a study on how those fats found in soil bacteria increase human resilience to stress and inhibit pathways to inflammation in the body. So that's just by sticking your hands in the soil to get a little bit of dirt, not wearing gloves. Maybe wiping your face as you do it, because your nose gets a bit itchy. So there's tremendous benefits just for touching the soil.
Alright, so
this is one of our gardens out of Bondo. And here we've got some succulents, so we do a lot of propagation work. And then we pop them up. And a lot of visitors are given the option of taking them with them. So if you're actually in accommodation, you might take something home with you. If you're living in a car, it might be something tremendous amounts of people actually live in their cars, because that's all they've got left. So you've got a little companion overnight in the car, something that's part of you've made to create your activity. A lot of people are couch surfing, particularly women in their 50s at the moment. A lot of women are becoming homeless as cost of living goes up and the money runs out. So it can be something you can take back to where you're starting to share with the person that you're staying with. And that can help to rebuild some of the fractures that occur in relationships when you are couch surfing. But often this alters our options. Another activity, dried herbs. We actually package our own seeds. So we grow seeds in the garden, we process the seeds and package them up. So there's a lot of literacy involved in that. So it'd be quite difficult to write botanical names. Some of our harvest, so we've got a native dress, and we've also got something you might recognise, which is lemon myrtle. So we do deliveries to 5 different restaurants at King's Cross each week. We share the food with our gardens, the visitors take it home, and then the Bondi Garden provides a lot of food to the street kitchen at our drop-in facility there, but also to our Heart Cafe, which is a new training facility, which is basically a fantastic Bondi-style restaurant, or cafe, which has all of its funding going back. Any money it makes goes back into our youth services program, and the kids actually train through the kitchen and through the cafe itself. But it's at that level, it's not at that level. The idea is we want people to go into real world jobs and break that poverty cycle.
So back here we've got First Nations agriculture, so this is Murong, which is the yam daisy. And yam daisies are the staple diet of much of the East Coast and west of the mountains, from the Darling Downs around to Adelaide, and from Newark Country down past Nowra around to Adelaide on the coast. Staple diet for about a quarter of a year, for First Nations for over 30,000 years. Something most people don't seem to know about. Right, so this is a study done by community breeding. So community breeding is a group that's a company run by the Botanic Gardens, and they support community gardens and social housing, and they support community gardens in low-income schools. So 350 social housing projects with gardens across the state, over 500 infant schools with public gardens. So they did a study on their new gardens to look at what was community garden doing. They found that the elevator new Alright, so I went for a walk near my house. Now this is at the side of the old children's hospital. And the old children's hospital is in Camperdown, and now it's a housing development, it's a high-rise building. So if we look at this, this is a pretty uninviting, just walk past me, I'm boring. Okay? And this is actually quite typical of a lot of the front gardens and back gardens across the hospital and the North Shore. Okay, it's not a lot of colour, just hedges. It's easy maintenance, it's pretty boring, it doesn't do anything for you, so it does nothing at all. This is across the road from there. It's out the front of a different block. And you can see you've got this lush tropical garden where you can actually sit in there and immerse yourself in nature. So this is an example of really positive public planning for gardens. This is a little bit further down the track, and you're starting to walk down towards Centennial Park by Centennial Park there. See couples that are holding hands and walking in the distance. There was a guy walking his dog talking on his phone, but he wasn't really engaging with the place. You've got apartments just on the right there and a little lawn, but they're hidden by the building. Then you've got where the creek used to be on the left, so it's just a big concrete tunnel, but there's enough pavement to sort of screen through. A little bit further down, you get this sort of thing. Now, it's kind of nice having trees, but it's not an enriched habitat, so there's nowhere really to sit there. Children might be able to swing around the trees as they're running around them, but that's about the only creativity you get. You don't really get any screening at the houses, so you don't feel like you're in a private area. And then this next to that, you start getting, there's actually a bush care group that works right the way down that valley. And so they've started to put in native plants back into the park, so it's got more of a bushland feel. So you can see a chair there, it's probably facing the wrong way. You've got these things in public discourse where if you've got a seat in the park, you have to be able to see everyone. And partly that's informed by the way that, that women feel safe within places. But often, and I'll show you a seating area a little bit further down, it's quite small, where you actually get that sense of security, but you're still able to engage with the bushland around you. So this is a bit further down, and we're down now. At this point, we're sort of in amongst a newer development. We've got apartments on the right, we've got apartments on the left, you've got Cleaver up on top of the escarpment there. And I'm standing outside the old Tranbrook Depot, which is now a fancy shop on the wall with food and things like that. So, places like this, you've got younger trees, maybe those buildings will be screened out a little bit, and they won't be looking at each other across grass in about 5-10 years' time. The sort of place that's ideal for a community garden. It actually brings people down out in the apartments to talk to each other. At the moment, there's no reason to leave your apartment apart from to go down to get coffee. So this is a little seating area a little bit further down from there, and it's not that far from that previous shot. You've got these paper bags. So this is where you can actually start to engage with nature. Now, I'm just actually sitting on a little bench, while I'm doing this, and just stopping. And, at times there are little birds going through, insects rustling in the trees. Now right next to that, across the path, you've got this. So that's actually the entirety of the area, but it's a recreation of the salt marsh that, that the park used to be. So it's used as a water retention to control water flow. But there's a lot more life and energy, and it's immediately a lot more calming. Okay, so the point of this is studies are showing us that engaging with nature has a positive effect on our well-being. Okay, so one study managed to get it down to 20 minutes a week, but that's not really what it's all about. Most studies are saying a minimum for a starting level to get a positive elevation in mood and a reduction in stress is about half an hour a week. Okay, now, if you look at Arabic cultures, which up until last century were largely nomadic, a lot of people are now settled in cities. They actually go out into the desert and they camp with the family during holiday periods. So Australian families will go camping in the bush and it has the same effect. Okay? In countries like Japan, which are much more intense in population, you've got this thing called Shinrin-yoku. Now, Shinrin-yoku roughly translates as forest bathing. And it's been public policy in Japan through the health system to promote forest bathing or engagement in nature every week since the early 80s. Okay, now I googled the word, the term on the internet, all these American companies came up, so they've come up with the word, and they seem to think that Shinrin-yoku was invented in the 80s. It goes back into ancient times. It's like saying Australians only started camping in the 80s. You know, that's not what it is. It's a cultural practice. Okay, but it's actually been codified into the healthcare system. Okay, so this is a sort of on my way back on my walk. So you can see there's two houses. Now, as I walked up the street, you know, a couple of kilometres to get home again, you've got all these little workers' cottages. And about half of them have got plants out the front, and half of them don't have any plants out the front. So, locked door, shutters, no real life to the street. The only plants in the front are just weeds that have come up and haven't been looked after yet. Then a whole bunch of houses like this, they had pots, they had little trees. They filled to the front, all their windows were open. Okay, if their windows weren't physically open, the curtains were open. The houses were exposed to light and air. So what I'd like to see, someone actually do a study on the mental health of the people who live in the houses. You know, what does being shut into a house with the windows closed all the time actually do to your mental health? Because we know that engaging with nature is actually something that is a positive thing for us. So you've got another study by a woman called Garson Brown, and she's from Auckland in New Zealand, but she's got a landscape practice in the UK. And she did a stress response study. So what they did was they took three populations, business as usual, people they sit in an outdoor shopping mall type garden, and people that they sit in a horticultural therapy garden that's designed as a horticultural therapy garden. So lots of points being engaged. Trees to climb, mud to splash in, things to touch, things to smell, things to taste, all that sort of stuff. And they didn't actually have therapists with them. They just did, you know, blood tests and psych tests and evaluations at the beginning and end of each week. And they found that the control group, no surprise, slight elevation for excitement being part of the study at the beginning, and then it just went back to normal. The people who are in shopping mall gardens, unfortunately, in general, apart from one person who was an outlier, slightly negative effect on your psyche. So a couple of pots, concrete mall, not very good for you. Okay, not a great place to relax, not part of nature. Whereas when they went into the horticultural therapy garden, people had an elevation in nature, reduction in stress. And they're doing that through the psych tests and also through blood tests to test for certain chemicals in the bloodstream. So, you know, these studies are also done in nursing homes, so they found you get a lot of high-rise buildings with locked
psych wards now for people who have dementias and things like that. All they had to do was sort of have a picture window where you could look out at nature, okay, in the common areas or out of the bedrooms. Or, quite easily, you could just put a picture up in the hallway and a bench in front of it. People thought they were in nature, and it actually elevates the mood of the inpatients. Okay? The more advanced, larger nursing homes with outdoor space are now doing figure eight paths. You know, so people are just wandering in figure eight through fields of flowers. Okay? And they can wander all day, and there's plenty of places to sit. They're getting their exercise, and that elevates the mood and stops a lot of the behavioural disorders that they're otherwise exhibiting.
There's a whole bunch of studies on that sort of thing. Okay.
Now, another study that really interested me when I was researching for this
was from Denmark's Aarhus University. So they did a study showing that if children grew up in areas surrounded by green space,
so parks, natural areas, and they had access to those spaces, as adults, it diminished their chance of developing psychiatric illnesses by 55%.
So they actually studied 16 different mental disorders. So they included things like schizophrenia and OCD.
So just having that access, you know, growing up to green space and not keeping your kids in the apartment is really, really important.
Okay, so how do we create the spaces?
So that's the question. So, one of the spaces that I've been involved in is community gardening. So community gardening is a really big thing in Sydney now. It's not across all council areas. Some councils have one or two. When I was living in the city of Sydney, I think they've got up to 25 different community gardens. And
the suburbs, you might have 20 or 30 community gardens up and down throughout the eastern suburbs between the three different councils.
So this is a community garden in a, so what you have is social housing, which is run by the government, and then you have a privatised form of social housing. So there's at least four or five, if not 10 companies in Sydney, which are part owned by the government and also owned by investors, and they build social housing. And they have a little bit more control over who lives there than you do in a typical social housing project, and more ability to move the tenants around. But because you've got these really diverse populations, you need to have point of contact with people. So one of the projects I've worked on was putting in five different community gardens in, you know, for one of these companies.
So we had
varying levels of success.
Now, there was a study recently that came out of Sydney Uni, and it was by Thompson, Corkery and Judd from the Faculty of Built Environment. So they looked at a high-rise social housing block in the inner west, and they found, know, where they'd actually put a community garden in. And they found a positive physical, psychological well-being outcomes for individuals, and improvements in diet and enhancement in building healthy and social well-being. So that's a really big change. So I look at that as social permaculture. So you've got this, you know, style of living called permaculture. So it's the development of healthy and sustainable food systems. But it's also has the concept of social permaculture, where we all work together for a common goal as one of its, you know, primary motivators for permaculture.
Okay, so I'm just going to go back. So James Street in Redfern was the first community garden that I got involved in. So James Street garden is in a location where you had a lot of drug dealers. So it meant that even though it was up the laneway from my house, you didn't want to walk through it with 10 of your best friends in the middle of the day. It just wasn't safe. Okay. Now, you had a lot of women in the street at the time who school, but they didn't want to walk down Cleveland Street where you've got all the traffic. They wanted to walk through the back lane. And so we activated the space by putting in a community garden. And within about 3 months, it had gone from being a space where you wouldn't go with 10 of your best friends in the middle of the day to a space where single women could walk through at night. So that's a huge social change to start with. But what it also did was it activated the local community. So not everyone wants the garden, but a lot of people like to walk past gardens. And the way it activated the community was people actually stopped to chat. And you didn't necessarily get someone's name, but you got a hello, and all of a sudden you actually knew people in the street. So I was involved in the garden for 5 years, and then my landlord came back from overseas and I had to move to another suburb, so I stopped engaging there. When I go back to Redfern now and I do a bit of shopping, I find that no one will stop me in the street and have a chat. So the older members of the community, because they kind of miss those sort of chats that we have when I was in the garden. So you have this tremendous social activation as part of that. So we've got a community garden. This is on the south side of a high-rise apartment, a social housing block. This is on the roof of another social housing block. The only kickback we got in the building was actually from the people who had windows that look into the barbecue area, because no one used it, but it was a barbecue area. All of a sudden, it's a community garden. The barbecue started getting used and people started going there. The kids actually started taking their parents up there. You know, even if the parents weren't engaging in the garden itself, it became a hub for the community. Now this is another rooftop garden that I've worked on, and this is a non-trackable rooftop space on a property in Tamarama, and we've turned it into a vegetable garden. So you can see the neighbour's house. We're about two stories in the air at this point. Because the house goes down the slope. You can see we've got lots and lots of diversity in colour. And also seed collecting. And a lot of those flowers are edible. And this is last winter. So you can see things like the pandan on the left with the pipes from Singapore. So the pandan on the left is yellow and off. Doesn't have the flavour to get in summer. Whereas the celtus on the right is starting to go to sea. So the celtus is the settlement that is controlled properly by a lot of Chinese communities in Australia. Unfortunately, I don't know its traditional names, because different people from different regions have different names for the plants, and it's hard to learn more. Okay, so this is back to James Street. So one of the other things about James Street is you have all these people that work in the area. We don't have anywhere to have lunch because all the parks are sort of like a bench and some grass and maybe a tree. They're pretty unengaging and boring. So as soon as we got the garden growing, we found a lot of people now going to sit there for lunch. And so they've got this relaxing space that's a little bit crazy and wild, you know, where there's things going on in terms of insect life, bird life, all that sort of stuff. But there's also a feeling of safety and security because it's designed like someone's crazy backyard. And that's a really important difference you often see between outer urban and country gardens and inner city gardens. A lot of the inner city gardens are a lot more creative in their expression. So we get to harvest things, so persimmons. And then this is a community run garden that I work at every Friday for Ramwood Council. So Ramwood Council has community gardens. Community gardens are run by groups of citizens who live in that area. Whereas a community run garden is actually run by an authority like a council, a church or another group. So I'd say the gardens I work in at Wayside Chapel are actually community run gardens rather than community gardens. So you have a retired couple who travel quite a bit, so they can pop in and out. They don't have the commitment you need to have for a community garden or actually a member of a set group that you have expected attendances and things that the jobs are going to do. They're people who just come in on a Friday when they feel like it. You've got a guy who's waiting for his visa to come through. He's got a high demand job, so he's just waiting for his visa to come through so he can take up his job offer. You often get shift workers. get a lot of foreign students coming through. It can be very difficult for foreign students to engage with local populations. A lot of people come to Australia to study thinking they're going to have all these Australian friends, and it doesn't happen. So we found we get a lot of foreign students coming in and engaging with the local community in that way. And you've actually got something, an activity to do as you go. This is the same space, so again, focus on life and flowers, relaxation. So, you know, we don't work too hard, we have a nice long morning tea. Alright, so this is a garden that I've been managing in Longaville for many years. So, I always found it a little bit bleak and sterile, but some people actually relate to this, and this is their calming place. So, from the house, you're actually looking through windows in the dining area and the kitchen and across the little patio that you can see into this nice cool green space. So, a lot of people respond to that, but I found that it's about 10% of women respond to it, maybe 60% of men respond to it as a cool kind of spot structure. Okay, so this is a very different space. It's actually got fake grass. It's got lark, it's a shady garden. So there's a green wall that's facing south. Not a lot of sun through the year. A little bit more in summer, but totally dark in winter, which is why there's sort of fake grass on the paper. So that's a sort of cheery little arm. I had the idea of a garden here at the back of the house when I was looking for it for the garden, so I had to invent something right away. This whole space has been rebuilt by the landlords who moved back in, and they've extended the house out into the courtyard. They've managed to capture the sun at this end of the garden. So this is a garden that I work on in Mosman. So this is the north end of the garden, and we've got a mix of native plants and exotics. The rest of the garden's largely native, but the only non-native in the rest of the garden is frangipani. This is a handle of wind on the site, so who knows what cover there. So this is a little bench. We've got a few veggies up the back. Because then the high-rise lots with fresh herbs. And there's a mix of sort of edible plants in amongst the flowering plants that can come down the aisles. But they can sit on the bench while they're waiting for a taxi, or look at the native bees when the grandkids are coming to visit. So this is my parents' previous house, so they've just sold this place. It's down in Pine, and that's looking into the front yard. So often with gardens, we become too obsessed by the street presence of the house. Okay? I always think the primary viewpoint is when you get home. So if you drive home, you've got a primary viewpoint from the driveway or the garage. If you're at home, it's having something nice to sit at the front and look into the garden. So you can see the windows sort of up on the left there. So that's where the kitchen starts, and you're actually looking out at the garden. And we have a bird bath and that sort of thing, and a tremendous number of small birds that came in. So it's creating that vibe. The tree is a West Australian tree, called Rose of the West. It has these beautiful pendulous grey leaves that bob in the wind when it catches the breeze, and then there's huge red flowers that occur seasonally. So birds love to roost in that, but you get a lot of movement in the garden, so that's another sort of sensory approach. So this is going back to that garden with the bench, and this is the sunset. So it's a nicely native garden. You get a lot of birds, you get water dragons, you get dragonflies that are on. And it's a really nice garden just to wander through and calm. The same garden again from a different view, different season. So here we're in winter, you can see the city over to the right, you can see some houses down there. One thing that people don't notice anymore is a huge white apartment building that's sitting above it, because they're actually engaged with the space down below. And for the elderly residents in the building, it's a really great space to be able to just wander through and reconnect, because there's nice little access. Okay, so this is back to my parents' front garden, so you can see pretty much the view from the front deck. So my parents used to sit out there with a glass of wine or a cup of tea in the evening, depending on the mood, and just watch all the birds and the life in the garden as the sun went down. Okay, and then this is the rear courtyard. So again, we're enclosed by greenery and life. So So this is a little courtyard in Redfern. So it's actually a light well. So we're in the basement level here. So the light comes down into the kitchen and the dining area. And you've got two stories of house above that. So it's creating a calm little courtyard with the water feature. And then you've got a courtyard out the back, which is represented by the bottom two photos. So little seating areas in lots of grasses. Pops the colour, brings the bees in. And here's this garden I didn't build. It was one of my volunteers at Wayside had this put in by some very fancy landscape designers, sort of around the corner of the house, sort of hides the differential in height. Gives you a cool green sort of oasis that's more like a white forest. This is a view out onto a balcony, King's Cross. So the clients have been having a lot of trouble getting people in because there isn't really great access to the building, there's no parking anywhere nearby, and getting anything done was crazy. But she wanted to have a little veggie garden, which means that she's actually looking after her little office space. So talking about a top flight lawyer who, you know, likes to go to relax a little bit, now she can get a little herbs for her meals, be a bit more sustainable that way, but also get back that part of a little bit of life right next to where she's working, which can just help you to refocus as you go along. So that's another garden I'm moving here this time. So it's a mix of natives and exotics. They could have, you know, relatively formal gardens that are still quite relaxing. And again, you know, the best view of this garden is actually from the front door, or from the driveway to the garden. Yeah, so there's someone in the room who recognises this garden. So this garden's about 6 months old at this point. So the client I worked for before across the road, the previous property, and we wanted to have, you know, something bushy and something habitat. So one of the really important parts of it is that you're at a point on the hill where you get a lot of birds and other life coming in. So it's part of the Habitat Stepping Stones program, which I think Chatswood Council's involved with.
That's what I've got, Habitat Stepping Stones.
I'm worrying. Runs that. Yeah. Okay, but there's a park above the house. We took out a huge tree that was kind of laurel that meant the backyard couldn't be used. But then that created a view down into the backyard. So the slope above the house is now being done by the resident itself. And all the neighbours is a little bush care project, and they've extended that down inside the house. So we've got this huge habitat effect within the garden. And this is just a 6 month point, so imagine what it looks like 2 years later. It's much more developed and full. Yeah. And it's a really nice place to go through. So a friend's place in Barony Park. So Barony Park has a lot of bushland. You go into the house and just relax straight away. So one of the things with gardening and going to the bush is observing the small things. And this is actually my front door last summer. A blue band of bees roosting at night time. And you can also bring a lot of plants indoors.
Okay, so just to sum up. So what are the things we can do in our everyday life that improve health and general happiness? So it's a mix of solitary and community activities, like at least half an hour a week on an activity. Find a local bushland area and walk through it regularly. So Chatswood is surrounded by amazing bushland valleys with really well-maintained paths. So to do that, if you don't want to do it by yourself, you join a bushwalking group. There's two types of bushwalking groups. You've got the runners, who just want to get there, and the new really long ones. And you've got the people who actually have a social chat and as they go along. And that's community building. Okay, so join a bush care or community gardening group. You know, they're really, really great ways of knowing your neighbours and engaging with the community. So bring life to your garden by planting flowers or creating habitat for life. So you want to go out into the garden rather than just sitting inside which you see it. So you can join a group. So groups like I'm in a group called Everest Seed Savers, and we chat about gardening and growing things each month when we have our meetup. So you've also got groups like Crop Swap Sydney, and people share their excess produce. You've got permaculture groups, you've got specialist plant societies. There are all ways of meeting people who love the social side of gardening. It's bringing the garden indoors and tropical plants, so indoors, outdoors, on your balcony. It's walking down the road and enjoying Sydney's amazing scenery. So the whole point is to regularly allow for unstructured time in nature or in an active garden space. So a place where you can actually engage and touch. Okay? It's not closing yourself off from engaging with people around you in the community. And it doesn't have to be on a set day of every week. And this is one of the really important things. It shouldn't be on the same day every week. It shouldn't be structured as part of a regular schedule. Okay? But it should happen every week. So if you miss a week, it's okay. But you actually want to be going out there every week for unstructured time. Because it's not relaxing to schedule and say, I've got half an hour to go for bushwalk. Then I've got to go and have coffee. Then I've got to go to work. Then I've got to do this. Then I've got to do that.
Alrighty, so do you have any questions?
Well, I've not had that long.
I just wondered where the best way to find out about local groups and resources. Some on the council website or?
Okay, so in terms of resources, most councils have information on their community garden and bush care activities, and they're a really good place to start. Not a lot of councils do active horticultural therapy programs. There's a fantastic program if you ever go on in Singapore, where they have a research-based approach, and they're actively installing therapy gardens as public spaces across the island. So I think they're up to 6 or 7 at the moment. We've got plans for another 10.
So much of a question. I mean, I live in North Sydney municipality. I live in the North Sydney municipality, and their bush care and their community gardens are extensive. And the plants to homes of development, plants, I don't know what really and some others. But I'm not sick of certain guys to have their groups of capacities now.
With North Sydney, you've got a tremendous resource of Colo, where they grow native plants, they have community gardens, they have a lot of public facilities. You find that in each cluster of councils, you'll have at least one that's accessible. A lot of them are funded through the New South Wales base levies, and the one that I work at in Cranbrook is funded by the base levy, which means that the programs are open to everyone. They're not often not charged, and they're free classes.
Just to respond to those two queries, from the City Council, yep. We have quite a few community gardens in the area.
Yep.
There's 5 at the moment.
Right.
We have very extensive bush care groups. A lot of that information is on our website. We have a food swap group that runs once a month. So, yeah, there's a lot of info on our website around that.
And they're really great things to engage with active members.
Any other questions? Give me a warm thank you to Jon for his talk this morning.